So thank you everyone for joining. This week we are pleased to welcome Julien Dere for the seminar. So Julien Dere is trained in engineering was trained in engineering in ESPCI, and then did his PhD on physics, and got also interest for biophysics, and that's what he will. He will present today his recent work on biophysics, and more specifically, the morphogenetic motions and posture regulation in plants. So the floor is yours.
Okay. Thank you very much, David. And okay, so I will put the full screen. And yeah, I'm very happy to talk to you today. So I didn't know about the existence of this Sony research lab in Paris, not too far from my university, actually. And I visited a few weeks ago, maybe 1 or 2 months ago. And okay, I really enjoyed the visit. And I started to talk about plants with David and Peter. And so you will see a little bit the kind of stuff I'm interested in. So today I'm going to talk to you about what we call the morphogenetic motion. So don't worry, I will tell you what it is. So I'm sure I prepared too many slides, but my objective for today is just to go quietly, and I want to give you like a nice introduction. An introduction on what are the morphogenetic motion in plants. And then I want to show you two examples of regulation mechanisms that we have in the development of leaves, in what we call the leaf unfolding. So I will show you two examples, one on a simple leaf, on the example of Persea americana, which is actually the scientific name for the avocado tree, and another example of the compound leaf. And I'm not sure I will have time to talk about what is multiscale, but it's okay. Maybe I will quickly give you some perspectives on my work. But so just to start on the introduction, as David mentioned, I'm maître de conférence at Université Paris Diderot, and I am in this lab called MSC, which stands for Matière et Systèmes Complexes. Matter and complex systems. And so we are interested in a wide variety of stuff, but in physics, you have people who are interested in the microscopic stuff, like quantum physics, very small. You have people interested in cosmology, very big systems. And our lab, it's all in between. It's what we call macroscopic physics. You have like fluid dynamics, you have biophysics. You have everything which happens at the scale, at the human scale. So you see, some people are interested in the physics of soap films. Here you see an example of some microfluidics device to see a colony of bacteria. Here you have some droplets, bouncing droplets. So it's some hydrodynamics. And here you have the Romanesco cabbage. You see you have some fractal pattern. And I showed these graphics because this is what we have in the banner of the website. So it's kind of historically the typical interest of the lab. And myself, I'm interested in self-organization and morphogenesis in general, but in particular in plant physics. So I'm going to show you some plants today, and I will try to have the point of view of the physicist to try to measure things and to understand what is the physics behind the plant development. So, that's what I told you. I'm going to focus on plant.
On t'entend plus, Julien. sais pas ce qui s'est passé.
Ah, est-ce que c'est mieux là?
C'est mieux.
Qu'est-ce qui s'est passé? Je suis désolé. Alors j'espère qu'il n'y aura pas d'autres problèmes. Je suis désolé. So where did it stop? Là, ça va ou pas? Oh non!
Pardon, oui, ça va, excuse-moi. Ça,
ouais, where did I stop? Where did it stop?
Just before I told you. Yeah.
Okay, sorry, I hope. Qu'est-ce qui se passe? Oh là là, la misère. Ah, je suis désolé, qu'est-ce qui se passe? Je suis désolé. Il se passe des. Okay, so I was talking about the plant. I'm going to focus on plant motions. And when you talk about plant motions, you have to be careful about which time scale you are dealing with, because you have very different time scales in plants. You have very fast motions. You all know about the Venus flytrap. It's a carnivore plant. And you see the motions are very fast. It's the motions are typically the time constant are due to elastic phenomena, so it's very fast. Then you have some other motions which are linked to some water movement, so it's quite fast. I mean, at the human scale, it's not so fast, but you can see it in real time. Okay, this is a sensitive plant. And then you have much slower motions, which are linked to growth. You see, and you need some time-lapse imaging to see the typical motions you have due to the growth of the organs. And what we are going to look today, we are going to look at the motions of growth due to the development of organs and the leaves in particular. So first we can start with just the observation. So we did some observation in the lab. Here you have two of my colleagues, looking at plants in the lab. So you can do time-lapse imaging in the lab. Here is a mimosa plant. And to see the time scale, you can see the day-night cycle. Here is the day and you saw the night before. So you can see that you have very rich motions due to the growth of this plant. You have motions which are, on the same phase as the day-night cycle, but you have also motions much faster. We also, we had the chance to go in the forest, in the tropical forest, to do some investigation, in the forest. And so we have also some observations. Here is a puruma. You see the leaf of the puruma, which is developing very, very slowly. You have here the typical time going, so it's going quite slow. When it's black, it's the night, and then you have you see the hours going. So you see some motions which are related to the development of the leaf. You have some other plants also in the forest. Here it's a compound leaf, and you see some kind of swinging motions. So these swinging motions, I will talk about it more in detail very soon. And here is another example. It's the Mimosa pudica, the sensitive plant. But when you look at the development, you have also some very, very rich and complex motions. So that's kind of the qualitative observations. You see really very complex behavior. So actually, people have tried to classify all these kind of motions that we can see in nature, and you have three kinds of important dichotomy. The first question you can ask is about the growth irreversibility. Is it a reversible motion? For example, in the case of the sensitive plant, you can touch the plant, you will have a motion, but then it will go back to the normal state. So you can have reversible motions. You can have also some irreversible motions. You have another dichotomy, which is the directionality. if the directionality is imposed by the outside, for example, you have motion which are that we call tropism. Maybe you've heard about that. The tropism is when a plant is going back to verticality, for example. It's called gravitropism. You have tropism due to the light. It's called phototropism. The plants will go towards the light. So the directionality is imposed by the outside. Some other motions, the directionality is imposed by the inside. It's the second kind of dichotomy. And the last dichotomy that people use traditionally, it's the trigger. If the trigger is imposed by the external world, like for example in the sensitive plants, we say it's a paratonic trigger. But if it's imposed by the plant itself, we say it's autonomic. So traditionally, people have kind of differentiated the different kind of motions. But what we realized is that you have some gross motions that I'm going to show. One, for example, is a nutation. Maybe you all have heard about the nutation. Nutation is what you have at the end when you have, at the end of the video here, you see you have the apex, the top, which is going to make circles. Whoop, hopla, like that. Moving like in circles. This is called the nutation. And the nutation, it's just an example of a morphogenetic motion, which is very complicated because it's not in the traditional classification. And so it's a peculiar place of these morphogenetic motions. But first, maybe I will, I put some basic slides about what is plant growth, because maybe you are not all familiar with, how plant growth works. So I just put a few slides to give you the basics. The basics of a plant cell, the plant cell are they're very different than animal cells, because they have a cell wall. So you have the cell here, but you have a cell wall which is very resistant to stress. So actually, in the plant cell, it's basically, for a physicist, the plant cell is just a big reservoir of water and some other stuff. And due to osmotic pressure, you have inside, you have a lot of different compounds. It can be different sugars or different, typically it's some different kind of sugars. You can build an osmotic pressure. That means that by osmosis effect, the water will move inwards, and you're going to fill all the volume, and even more, you're going to build an osmotic pressure. And thanks to the resistance of the cell wall, you can build this osmotic pressure to a very high value, actually. The typical formula of the osmotic pressure, it's the concentrations times R times T. If you do the calculus with typical molar concentration of sugars inside the cells, and you put like 300 kelvins, you get pressures which are typical order of magnitude, it can be up to 5 bars. So it's huge. It's very big, and you need a cell wall to resist this very big pressure. So, of course, you have a balance between the hydrostatic pressure, which is osmotic from osmotic origin, and the stress in the cell wall. And the question is, what is the rheology for the cell wall? So, there are some historical evidence back to 1959, that there is some kind of viscoplastic effect in the cell wall, because if you put some, you need some threshold, so you have a plastic threshold for deformation. You need a threshold after a given pressure. If the pressure is bigger than a yield threshold, you start to have some viscous deformation. And so in 1965, Locart developed the first viscoplastic model, where you say that typically V dot is the relative growth rate of the volume. And you can say that it's proportional to the difference between the pressure and a threshold of the pressure. That's the first equation, the equation number two. But you can also say that the relative growth rate is due to the intake of water. So it's due to, because you have some porosity in the cell wall and in the membrane, the increase of the volume is going to be proportional between the difference between the osmotic pressure and the real pressure. So you can, okay, you can do some computation for different cases, and Locard shows that at one dimension, for typical cells which are very one-dimensional, you have some nice, you can understand nicely what happens. So, okay, so that's the basics. I just want you to, to remember that typical plant growth is just some inflating of the cells due to osmotic pressure that we call turgescence pressure. And so that's for the growth. Now the question is, what is the link between the local growth and the motions that we are seeing? So to understand the link, you have to go in what we call the theory of morphoelasticity. The theory of morphoelasticity is to say that if you have a given body, stress-free, T is the stress tensor here, if you have a given body stress-free, you impose some growth due to biological growth, you're going to grow everywhere on the tissue, you're going to go in a virtual configuration where you are deformed, but you stay stress-free. But the deformations you have, they are not necessarily compatible. Of course, in reality, you need to have a compatible deformation. So you're going to relax from this virtual state to the real observable state due to elasticity. And basically, what you observe, the transformation you observe from the rest state to the observable observed state, it's the combination of the two. It's the combination of the growth and on the elastic deformation. So all that is just to say that the deformation you observed, it's linked to the growth field, but it's modulated by the elasticity. So then the motion you observe, it's kind of indirect witness of the growth. But you need to do some assumption on the elasticity. So if you have a very simple geometry, for example, imagine you have a nearly one-dimensional geometry. If you grow more on one side than on the other side, if you assume that the elasticity is very simple and you don't have residual stress or residual strain, you can just say that the motion you observe is directly linked to the growth. So that's why the plant growth, they're very interesting because they are directly linked to the growth, to the biological growth. Okay, that's a little bit the motivation of studying the plant growth motions. So I don't know if you have, so that was for the introduction. I don't know if you have some questions about that, you can maybe ask them now before I go into more detail in the different examples. Or else I will continue. Now I'm going to give you, two short stories about specific morphogenetic motions in the simple leaf and in the compound leaf. So here are my model systems. The simple leaf, it's Persea americana. So it is the avocado tree. So you see, it's a nice simple leaf. In first approximation, it is just a surface with one midrib, the central vein that we call the midrib. Of course, you have secondary veins, but which are much smaller than the midrib. So we are going to neglect them, physically speaking. And the second example, it's the Averroa carambola. it's the star fruit tree. Maybe you notice this fruit, the star fruit. It's a fruit that people use in pastry to decorate some pastries. And what you have to understand is that the compound leaf, it's all this stuff, is a compound leaf. So the simple leaf is just one surface, but the compound leaf, it's made of a lot of this elementary stuff that we call foliole. So it's like if the compound leaf is made of a lot of small simple leaves. So what is interesting for us, the compound leaf, it can be approximated by a 1D curve here. And on this 1D curve are attached all the folioles. Okay. Okay, so let's start with the simple leaf. So I'm going to show you a video of development of the avocado tree. So it's very accelerated. You see here the days. You see two leaves. And okay, I let you see a little bit. You see there are two kinds of motions. There is one motion of the midrib. You see that the midrib is changing its curvature. It's swinging. You have swinging of the midrib. And if you look in detail, okay, it's not so easy to see, but you see that the lamina is fluttering. Maybe I put it back on the beginning. You see that the lamina is, you have some buckling events. You see, you change. So the midrib is swinging, and at the same time, you have the buckling events, and you have the opening angle of the lamina, which is changing sign. The lamina is curved on one side, and then it's curved on the other side, back. So to make it more clear, okay, so you have this very specific buckling event. So first, what I want to tell you is that, okay, if I manage to change, okay, is that this phenomenon of buckling, it's actually quite typical. And for example, you see here also on the oak tree, it's development of oak tree. You see, you have also this buckling event, this surface, which is curved downwards, it buckles, to go upwards. You see it also on the, if you look at a compound leaf, but I told you the compound leaf, it's an ensemble of a lot of folioles, and each foliole looks like a simple leaf. If you look here, you see the buckling events of the folioles. And you also see it on the puruma. It's a folded leaf, but each fold looks like also a simple leaf. And you see this kind of buckling event. Okay. So what we did, that was just to tell you, it's kind of a general, a very typical phenomenon in nature. And what we did is that we look at in detail at this phenomenon in the case, in the case of the avocado tree, we did some very naive 3D reconstruction. So you see, we did some stereoscopy. You see here the leaf thing with two cameras from the left eye, the right eye, and we painted some dots, and so you can reconstruct in 3D the surface. And so you can have access to the geometry of the surface. And you remember, I told you, there are two important stuff. You have the curvature of the midrib here, and that is going to be labeled by kappa parallel. What I call kappa parallel is the curvature parallel to the midrib. Okay. And you have, so if kappa parallel has one sign, for example, if it's positive, it's curved downwards. If it's negative, it will be curved upwards. Okay. And then you have phi, and phi, I call that the opening angle here. When you look at the lamina can be downwards, phi negative, or you can have also phi positive if it's upwards. So we plotted all this stuff. So the first graph, don't bother too much. The first graph, it's only the position of the baricenter of the leaf. It's just to show you that you have some typical day-night cycles. You have the gray zone when it's the night, the white zone it's the day, and you see you have typical oscillations 24 hours or one day oscillations which are due to the day-night cycles. But then we plotted the kappa parallel curvature. You see it changes sign, so that's not surprising because we saw this swinging motion. And when you look at phi, the angle, you see that the phi is changing sign at the same time as kappa parallel, and it's but very quickly. You have these buckling events very quick. What is surprising actually is that you see that this effect is happening with a different period than the bicenter period. So it's not an effect which is due to the day-night cycle. It's an effect, okay, independent of the day-night cycle. If you plot the two, one versus the other, you see nicely it is a correlation. So you see kappa parallel, which is correlated to phi, the opening angle. And so you see the clear correlation, and you have a gap here, which is due to the buckling effect. So there is a question. Okay, let me see. I look at the time. So it's okay. It's an interesting correlation because it's not trivial. For example, if you okay, so we can ask the question: what are the ways to explain it? Actually, if you look at some, so I don't know. I hope you see my camera here. If you take just a piece of paper, which has a curvature. There is a passive effect which is due just to the Gauss effect. When you have an isometric deformation, you have a conservation of Gauss curvature. Okay, so if you imagine that the midrib is controlling the motion, when the midrib is curving more, so that's kind of an artificial leaf. If I curve more the midrib, you see. I hope you see. That orthogonally, the lamina, the curvature orthogonal is decreasing because by conservation of the Gauss curvature, if you increase one of the principal curvature, you should decrease the other one. So you see that this effect, this passive effect, goes in the wrong side because, okay, maybe I plotted at the end, I plotted it together, the in orange, it's the passive effect. We see that when kappa parallel increase, phi also increase. But the passive effect will be the opposite. So the simple passive effect of isometric deformation doesn't explain what we see. And then one could say, okay, there is also an active effect because we know we have some growth in the midrib, in the vents, and the midrib can be considered like a bimetallic strip. And if I grow more, for example, on the top than on the bottom, I'm going to curve in the parallel direction, but I'm also going to curve in the orthogonal direction. Actually, you can compute this effect. You know that the angle phi will scale like kappa parallel with a prefactor, which is typically the size of the midrib. But when you put the two together, if you fit the typical slope, you don't find, I mean, experimentally, we find an effect which is 10 or 100 times bigger than what we can compute with this midrib contact angle effect. So that's what is interesting in these experiments, is that we evidence a very stereotyped motion which cannot be explained by the simplest model. And so you need to go to further more complicated explanation. And there is one explanation which is very, okay, we didn't prove it, but we have a lot of okay hints. Is that, you remember I told you that, for example, you have this leaf here. I told you that if you uncurve, so the black arrows here, it's to simulate if you uncurve the midrib, I told you that you have a competition between the active effect, the bimetallic strip, which would like to go to the top, okay, because you go in the same direction, but the passive effect, conservation of Gauss curvature, goes in the opposite direction. So you're going to put some tension in the lamina. And we know, biologically speaking, that if you have some stress in the lamina, you can have some mechanosensitivity effect. So you can have some growth control related to what is the stress which is felt by the leaf. And so this kind of motion, so that's why it's kind of, it's a charming hypothesis, at least, to say that this kind of motions, they enable to put tension in the lamina, and it's a way for the lamina, for the leaf, to know what is deformation. Because of this motion, it puts some tension in the lamina, and that's why we say, okay, it's a provocative statement, but it's to say that this motion is a way for the plant to feel its deformation and maybe a way for it to reach flatness. And that we just have some indicators, but we have shown that we have some really nice fine tuning of the spatiotemporal growth. Because, for example, if you average on all the experiments, you see this is a color map of the leaf, and you see that the growth is not homogeneous. And actually, the growth is, you can fit it here, the growth is made so that the plant is more and more flat. And actually, you have we computed the gauche curvature, of the leaf, and the gauche curvature is, as a function of time, it's oscillating, but it's decreasing, and it's going asymptotically to zero. So it looks like you have a regulation to go to flatness, and the mechanism of mechanosensitivity, it's one possibility to explain it. So that was the okay. Maybe I can show you. Okay, I don't know if it's going to work. Yeah, this is a video of the growth. Okay, the color codes for the growth, but it's dynamic as a function of time. You see, you have a very complex spatiotemporal pattern of the growth. For now, it's way too noisy to really say something. We just see that there is a lot of spatiotemporal interesting dynamics. And one point which interests me is that I want to quantify the same with much better resolution. And that's why I'm very interested in by the setup that you have at Sony to try to do a 3D of plants, because when you have a 3D motion, all the projection effects are very big, so you need to have very, very high precision of the kinematics to be able to get rid of all the projection effects. And so that's just the end of the first story I wanted to tell you. Maybe David, you can tell me how much time do I have?
10 to 15 minutes.
10 to 15 minutes. Okay. So I'm just, so 10. Okay. Perfect. So it's perfect. So I'm just going to tell you, because I want to give you the second example. So that was the example for the simple leaf, where you have regulation on the gauche curvature, so regulation of the flatness. But the second system, I show you the video and then I will tell you So it's this plant Averroa carambola, and so 15 minutes. I'm just writing, and so I put back at the beginning. So all that is a leaf. You see, all this hook shape, all that is a leaf, and here again you see different things. You see the most striking, at least to me, is that you have a lot of stuff going on in the motions, but you see that the plant manages to regulate very well the straightness of the what we call the rachis. The rachis is this 1D curve on which you have the little folioles. So you see you have all these motions, but at the end you have a perfectly straight rachis, and so you have some regulation mechanism of the rachis. And about the motions, you see you have the some kind of unrolling of the hook shape, and you saw also that you have this out of plane motion, and that's what we call the nutation. I told you quickly about nutation at the beginning. The left right motion, it's what we call the nutation. So we studied separately these two things. First we studied the hook shape, and then we studied the nutation. So I will go quickly on these two mechanisms. Here again, that's our canonical plant, Averroa carambola, but this hook shape, you saw it in nature in a lot of plants, in a lot of compound plants. That's 5 different plants, and here it's Averroa carambola. And on very different plants, you have the same characteristic hook shape. And so what we did the kinematics of this hook shape. So you have the rachis here. We defined arc length S going from zero to the apex. And we defined again the curvature kappa parallel or K parallel, which is the curvature in the main plane of this plant. And here is what we call the spatiotemporal diagram. That means as a function of time, here you have the time. We plotted as a function of the space, here the arc length, we plotted in color the K parallel, the curvature, the main curvature. And you see at the beginning, at time zero, you see the plant is very small and very curved. And then as a function of time, time increases to the bottom and you see that the length increases. Maybe you see this oscillating stuff. The length seems to oscillate. It's because of this nutation motion. Because of the nutation motion, you have some projection effects and the length that we see is modulated. But what is very striking on this graph is that you have a very colorful zone, which is at constant distance from the apex. And so it's a zone, there is a propagation of, and this zone is propagating, it's propagating at a constant distance from the apex as a function of time. You see it's linearly propagating. And it's constant curvature more or less. It's always the same kind of color. So it's a zone of curvature, but it's also a zone of growth because you see here the folioles. Okay, the dark points, lines here, are the position of the folioles. So you see that the foliole, when it is in the growth zone, in the color or in the curved zone, it's moving in space. And when it goes out of the growth zone here, it stays constant in space. So you see, you have all these zones here where there is no growth anymore. And in the colorful zone, you have both growth and curvature. So you have colocalization of growth and curvature. And so we did some very simple experiment that we call the Mouliat test, because Bruno Mouliat is is a biomechanist. One of the specialists of biomechanics in plants. And he developed this very simple test, which is just to flip down the plant actually. And imagine in A, it's the plant when the leaf is very small, and then you flip it over. So gravity on A, gravity is to the bottom, and here you flip it over, so gravity is to the top. And you see that the curvature, the plant doesn't change. So basically it tells you that this shape, it's not due to gravity, it's just due to intrinsic spontaneous curvature. And actually, if you superimpose the two pictures, you see it's nearly the same. Okay, so when the leaf is very small, if you see a curvature, it's a spontaneous curvature, it's not due to gravity. Actually, you could have guessed this result Because here, okay, the scale bar, it must be, I think it's maybe 5 millimeters, the scale bar. I'm not sure, but it's the order of magnitude of less than 1 centimeter, or maybe 1 centimeter. You can compute one typical characteristic lens, which is the elastogravity lens. The elastogravity lens is given by a balance between gravity forces and elastic forces, bending forces and gravity forces. And if you compute this lens, so B is the bending modulus, and the flexural rigidity. And if you compute this lens for the plant, it's about 6 centimeters. It tells you that if you have size less than 6 centimeters, you don't feel very much gravity. You feel only elasticity. So basically, the leaf here is much less than 6 centimeters. So of course, you don't feel gravity. Okay, is it true if you... okay, so I don't have time really to go in the detail, but basically you can go a little bit further than this simple test. You can compute the moment, which is either the elastic moment, which depends on flexural rigidity and real observed real curvature and spontaneous curvature. You can equal this moment to the moment of due to gravity. And basically, you have two unknowns in your problem, the flexural rigidity B and the spontaneous curvature. But you can have two equations because you can look at the plant gravity, normal gravity, or with gravity upward. I mean. And so you have two equations, two unknowns. You can solve for these unknowns. That's what we did at different stages. So here in A, you see a leaf which have different sizes. So it's day 1, day 2, day 3, day 4, day 5. You see that when it's very small, you see no difference. The dotted line, it's when you put the plant with gravity upwards. When you flip the plant. So when the leaf is very small, you see no difference. And you start to see some differences when the leaf is more than 6 centimeters. And anyways, what is interesting, okay, I kind of give you the short story, is that you can compute the spontaneous curvature. And you show that there is some spontaneous curvature, which changes a little bit. But what we find that what is regulated is not the spontaneous curvature, but it is the difference between the real curvature and the spontaneous curvature. And actually, the difference between the two, it's, okay, we showed here is what is seems to be regulated. And it's actually what is linked to the stress. Because you know the stress, the deformation and the stress, it's due to this difference. So here again, it's an example, okay, it's an hint to tell you that what is important for the plant, it is the stress which is felt by the plant. And okay, we are doing some computer simulation to try to simulate this stuff. Okay, I don't have time to go in the detail, but we could just come numerically kind of try to model the development of this hook. That's an old modeling, purely kinematics, but we can add this in the future. We want to add the mechano sensible term. But in a few minutes, I want to show you that we also investigated the out of plane movement, which is the nutation movement. So here it's a view in the main plane of unfolding where you have this hook, but you can also at the same time you can visualize from the top. And if you visualize from the top, you see this typical nutation movement, and you have, okay, you see the time here, you have left right, and you can do also the kinematics study of this nutation. And that's what we did. We have again some kinematics, spatio-temporal kinematics. So here, it's kappa orthogonal, it's the orthogonal curvature of the Rashi. And okay, it's again some kind of spatio-temporal, but okay, it's oriented differently than before. You have the time here, okay, and you have the space here. and you see that the plant is, okay, here at the beginning, it's only 8 centimeters and it's going to grow. It's going to grow until like 20 centimeters. And you can plot the curvature and you see this oscillation here. So here we don't see very well. So you can look at the, you can, with very simple morphoelastic assumptions, by assuming that there is no residual stress, for example, you can compute the differential growth between the left and the right, and you can plot the envelope here, and you see again that you have a zone, you have a special zone where you have differential growth. You can compute the average growth by looking at how the folioles are expanding, and you can, what is interesting is that you have a growth law. You can, in red, it's the average growth, and in green, it's the differential growth. And it's plotted as a function of the apex here. Zero is the apex. You see that from the apex, you have a zone where you have a lot of average growth and you collapse, you go to zero. And it's specifically when you are at the edge that the differential growth, which makes the motion, is maximum. And what is interesting, you see, is that the value here of the differential growth is nearly the value or is about the same as the average growth. That means that you can have even some contractions. That means that you really have a stop and go mechanism where you grow on one side, you grow on the other side, you grow on one side, you grow on the other side, etc. And okay, I think I just have a few more minutes, so I think I'm going to skip. We try to do some experiments on pseudo zero gravity, but okay, I'm going to skip that. And we did some, I just want to sum up a little bit, just to show you, to tell you that I showed you two examples of morphogenetic motions which are associated to posture regulation. The simple leaf, you have this buckling effect where we saw that there was some evidence of mechanosensitivity mechanism, which is linked to the regulation of the flatness of the simple leaf. And for the compound leaf, you have the nutation motion and also some hints for mechanosensitivity mechanism, because we showed the importance of the kappa minus kappa zero. That means some terms which are linked to the stress, and it's also related to a very, very nice regulation, very straight leaf at the end. And I just want to take a few minutes to tell you what are my interests. Okay, now at longer terms, I have three interests that I want to tell you, but the first one, and that's why I contacted Peter and David in the first place, is because I'm very interested in improving the 3D of these motions. For now, we just have very rough 3D motions. And so we did some with Frank et Trois Wheeler, which is a collaborator I know of David. We did some first test of reconstruction on the Averroa Carambola. So you see here we did a multi-camera cage, and we can do the reconstruction. So for now we have very well the geometry, the 3D geometry of the plant. But what we would like to have is a precise growth field. We would like to know precisely how it's everything is growing. And so that's for my first sim. My second sim, it's we would like to go more into the mechanics of the plant. And we have a new PhD candidate that I'm co-directing with Dragen Zanki at the lab. We are looking at the tendrils. It's a very nice, okay, so you have tendrils on climbing plants. Here is a Bryonia dioica. You see, you do a lot of twisting. And the Vitis vinifera is just the vine. It's also making some very nice motions. Here you see I put at the beginning, it's a tendril of a vine, and you see very, very fast motion because, okay, now it's the night, you have the night, day-night cycle, which is kind of slow, and you have this very fast, very violent, so that's also some kind of nutation. And after some time, it's going to find an obstacle, and it's going to attach to it, and we did, it attach here, and you see it's going to pull on this, and we can compute, okay, it's attached to a force measurement, and we computed the force, and you will see that the force, it's absolutely not ridiculous. As a function of time, we computed the force, which can be nearly 100 millinewton, and that's for very small tendrils. And you see that you have also some buckling mechanism arriving when you pull. And so our idea is to explain that by, it's most probably some differential growth in the vine, which makes some buckling arriving and which generates the force. And so we are collaborating with Sébastien Neukirch, which is a specialist of mechanics, which can make some simulation of roads to try to understand a little bit what's going on. And I have also some interest, but maybe just quickly, I'm interested in looking in detail especially with Étienne Couturier, who got an INR recently, to investigate what is the growth in detail at the scale of the one cell. So we are investigating CARA, which is an algae with very, very big cells, like it can be more than a few centimeters of long, the cell. So it's more easy to, and here it's a growth of this algae. And so that's another project. And I'm also interested in general in morphogenesis. So I'm also interested in what is the shape of the leaves, not only the 3D motions, but what is the shape of the leaf and what is the shape of the network of the veins. And so that's another project with a starting PhD student, where we try numerically to reproduce the different shape of the leaf. But I think I'm arriving to the end of the time. So I just want to thank everyone who participated, and especially, so I want to thank especially Mathieu Rivière, who is a PhD student who works on Averroa carambola. So all the results on Averroa carambola, it's Mathieu Rivière. And I want to thank also Stéphane Dwody. Stéphane Dwody was the co-director of Mathieu, and he's the one who was interested in plants physics for a very long time. He started to work on plants together with Yves Couder, like a long time ago, and he's a specialist of phyllotaxis. So he's the one who introduced the plants in the labs, and I'm working closely with him and all the other people. And thank you very much all for your attention.
Thank you very much, Julien. Very nice talk. Very beautiful movies you showed. Is there any question? Maybe I can start with one. I'm curious to know what is the functional role of Mimosa pudica motions?
What is the what you said?
The functional role.
So that's an. So Mimosa pudica. So that's Mimosa. That's Mimosa pudica. You mean this one?
Yes.
So that's a question. You know, in biology, it's always. If the question is if it has been selected for, so of course you could say, for example when it's raining, if it's raining, you will feel the rain, and you will when you do these kind of motions, you're folding the leaf, and so you're decreasing decreasing the surface available to the rain, and you're maybe somehow protecting the plant to the rain. I don't know. That's kind of one.
Okay.
It's one easy answer. I don't know if it's true or anything, but it's one possibility, one selective advantage maybe. Then of course you have for carnivore plants it's more obvious, but for the.
And do you know for hop? I don't know if you see the hop for hop leaves. It seems that they fold completely at night, no?
For which one? For the.
The hop in beer, like in beer.
At the hop, hop in.
Houblon.
Ah, le houblon?
Oui.
Okay. Ah, that I don't know how it looks. Okay, it's also folded?
Not at this speed, not at the speed of Mimosa pudica.
Ah, yeah. You mean you have some sensitive sensitive motion, but much slower.
I don't know if it's sensitive, but it's really a full folding of a leaf.
Yeah, so you have different kinds of motion. You have the motions which are sensitive, but it can be slower than the Mimosa pudica. For example, the Averroa carambola that I showed you, it's actually a sensitive plant, but not as sensitive as Mimosa pudica. But okay. You have also some day-night cycle. For example, if I go back to here, for example, this is Averroa carambola. Here you have the morphogenetic motion on the young leaves. But if you look at the old leaves, you see?
Yes.
The old leaves, they have what we say, it's a circadian rhythm.
Okay.
You have a day-night cycle and you see? It's completely correlated to the. Here you have a little. When it's white, it's the day, and when it's black, it's the night. More or less, I think. Yeah, it works. And you see that the motion. Okay, if I put it back, you will see that the motion of the old leaves, they are completely correlated to the day-night cycles.
And actually, is it because the water intake is related to the
cycle? Yeah. Okay. So there are two things. One thing is that yes, the turgor pressure is changing with the day-night cycle because of some evaporation phenomena, maybe, or for sure the pressure. Okay, the osmotic pressure is changing as a function of time. But it's known on plants that you have also a real circadian rhythm. So you really have a memory effect, a short-term memory effect. And for example, this plant, if you put it in the total dark after some time, it will continue to oscillate with a 24-hour period.
Okay.
And it's kind of fascinating actually because this day-night cycle, it's optimized it's really adjusted on the light cycle. But you see that the motion starts before the day arrives. For example, here, the motions started just before.
Yeah.
So, you see that's the beginning of the light. But the motion is already induced, started. So that's kind of funny. There is a circadian rhythm which is adjusted on the day-night cycle, but it starts a little bit before. There is a little shift.
Okay, thank you very much. Felix, you had a question?
Yes, can you hear me?
A little bit. Perfect. It's not very loud, but yeah.
Is it now better?
Yeah, better.
Okay, perfect. Yes, thank you for the talk. It kind of reminded me of my old photosynthesis teacher who also always loved to explain everything with physics. A short thing maybe with the mimosa, as far as I know, the main hypothesis at the moment is it's against insects and small animals so that they are not eaten, so that when the leaf pulls away, it's less likely to be eaten by anything. But my question would be, do you ever investigate also what effects like temperature are on the motion? So is it modulated in a linear way or does it completely change? And I'm sorry, I'm outside.
Yeah, don't worry. No, sorry. And so thank you for the comment. Thank you. Yeah. So it makes sense. I said the rain, but yeah, the insects. It makes sense. And so for your question, yes. Sorry.
I can repeat the last one because of geese. I'm sorry. It was regarding is when you have, for example, things like temperature changes or growth rate changes. So how does it modulate it?
Yeah. So we did some experiments. So for example, on the mutation, okay, the typical mutation. The typical mutation of the Averroa carambola. Because it's a nice periodic motion, we did some experiments at different kind of temperature, and yes, there is an effect of the temperature on the period. And one hypothesis is that the growth is enhanced at higher temperature. And there is another aspect is that the rheology, growth, the chemical effect of growth can be enhanced by temperature, but you can also have a mechanical effect because the rheology of the cell wall can be dependent on the temperature. For example, the extensibility parameter, which is related to the effective viscosity of the cell wall, it can depend on the temperature. So, for example, I showed you very quickly. So, it's not a study that we are doing very quantitatively on the full plant because it's not so okay. It's not so easy. But it's something we are going to do on the algae, because on the algae, with Etienne, you have this kind of motion. For example, you have some spiral growth, and how the growth is affected by temperature, it will be easier to characterize on a nice cylindrical. It's a unicellular cylinder, so it will be easier to do more quantitative stuff. But just to reply shortly. We observed it qualitatively already on the mutation phenomena. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Peter, you had a question?
First, hello, Julien. It's really nice to see you again, and nice to be able to go deeper into your work. I had a first question, but actually you partially answered it already with Felix's question. One of the questions I had was whether the movement that you can observe, whether you could also try to detect potential stresses from that. For example, if there's water stress, you might still see the movement with the same frequency, but with a lower amplitude. I don't know, I'm just thinking, or the distance between the apex and the growth zone might differ. So did you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah. So, okay. I have thoughts, but I don't have experiments to show you. But it's something we would like to do. We would like to, we would like to repeat our experiments by putting, for example, osmotic stress in the plant to change the trigger to the trigger pressure. So that's one thing we want to do now. Yeah.
Okay. I had a second question, which is very generic. So, in terms of biological evolution, are some behaviors, I guess, did the early plants already show complex behaviors, or did some of these behaviors or effects came later in the later stage of evolution and are there sort of families of movements and behaviors that you can see?
I see what you mean. Do you mean if some of the so to reply on the evolution part, I'm not sure.
I mean, it's a bit out of the scope of the presentation, but just as a sort of general question.
Yeah. So maybe on the evolution part, I'm not sure I can really understand, but in your question, there is something interesting is that, for example, if we take the hook shape, okay, the hook shape of the, this shape, the hook shape that we find in a lot of species in the compound plants, we also find this shape in the hypocotyl. For example, if you take the plant when it starts germinating, you just have you grow the what we call the hypocotyl when you have the two cotyledons, and it's not a leaf yet, but you have a shape which is very very reminiscent of the hook shape of the leaf. And so people have been studying the hook shape of the hypocotyl in, for example, Arabidopsis thaliana, the kind of the model plant for biologists. And so you have some, so it's not an evolution of more complicated stuff, but it's maybe either it's evolutive convergence of this shape. Most likely, I think, because you have some advantage of this shape, maybe also with the role of protection. And but okay, so that's just the comment I wanted to do, because okay, that I can answer. If I think more about your question, you have also some other very generic things like mutation, for example. Mutation, you have some circonutation, which you have in a lot of different species. You always have some kind of circonutation. You have that for the stem, and then you have mutation for the leaves, which is not in circular, but just back and forth. And your question is, if, for example, in old species, you don't have too much this kind of motion, and then in more recent species, you will observe them. That's your question, right?
Yes, kind of, yeah.
And that I don't know. it's a very interesting question, but I don't know, because in all the... I would say that all the plants I've been looking at, they have quite a wide spectrum. In terms of if it's an old plant, and for example ferns are very old. You look at ferns, they are quite old, and they have already. If we go back, that's a fern here, and it's a very old plant, compared to dicotyledons. And you see that you have some, of course you have, okay, you have this unfolding, but I think you see already some kind of mutation movement,
right,
when you go a little bit. So you see this kind of, okay, you see the oscillating stuff, which is very reminiscent of the mutation. And so you already have this kind of morphogenetic motions, which are already there. So I don't know. But it's interesting. I should look in detail. Thank you for the question.
Well, thank you for the presentation.
Okay, Felix, yeah?
Maybe another question. Are you already thinking about certain applications where you believe it could be helpful that you can understand those physiology or the physical processes when it's about leaf expansion and mainly at the moment for your leaf expansion, but you have already ideas where to apply it then further into, for example, more complex plant models as an example or similar?
I will say that in general, studying this kind of stuff, it can give you idea of doing some biomimetism stuff. But maybe the more interesting for me is the project we have, the recent project I have with Dragan Zanki on the tendrils. And so there is something which is interesting is that you have some, the dynamics of rods. If you take elastic rods, you have a, okay, it's very rich, all the different kinds of configurations you can have on elastic rods, depending on how you prepare it. If you put some, what is the twisting you put at the beginning, etc. And you can have some buckling events. You can release elastic energy very suddenly, so you can have some kind of snapping effects. And so I would say that you could maybe guess. Okay, it's just general ideas, general concepts, but you could guess that maybe in the field of robotics you could have some applications of being able to control the using tendrils to control some snapping events, for example. That's maybe like the closest to an interesting application that I can think of.
Okay, thank you. I guess then you mean like soft robotics, those kind
Exactly. Soft robotics.
Trying to enter small spaces and so on.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, thank you very much.
Alienor,
I have a quick question because at SOLI we're also working on photosynthesis and we are wondering somehow up to where we can correlate it to the plant growth. So I was wondering if, for example, when you have your analysis of plant growth on your single leaf with I don't know which slide it was, but did you try to correlate it to quantum efficiency of photosynthesis and try to see if somehow it can be?
Okay, so that we didn't do at all. You mean, so for example, to try to I think David and Peter, they mentioned that that you were working on that. So what can you measure exactly? You can measure the by doing like spectrophotometry or
well, you just measure the fluorescence, and since it's in competition with the photosynthesis, it allows us to get the rate of photosynthesis, like how many photons are converted to the Calvin cycle.
This kind of stuff, for example, it will be doable on any kind of leaves, or you need a special plant modified.
No, it's a autofluorescence. Yeah. So yeah, they have equipment to do it on leaves. And basically, you just need one light, two different types of light, and maybe do it in the dark. But you just need to measure some ratio, difference of ratio when you send the same number of photons.
So that means typically you have normal light, and when you do the measurement, you just put the dark for some time. You do the measurement for a few seconds, and you with autofluorescence, you can know what is the photosynthesis activity of the leaf?
Yes. And quite locally, it depends on the resolution of your camera.
Okay, so basically you could even have a map of how much photosynthesis activity is done on locally in space.
Yes.
But the next question is, so you need to put the leaf on the what is the setup? It's but maybe okay. If you are interested, maybe I can contact you later. We can discuss maybe in detail. Maybe everyone.
Okay. It's just we were wondering how it could be related to growth because.
Okay. No. That would be maybe interesting to.
Because photosynthesis is happening everywhere, but only some parts are growing, and it's a.
Okay. Yeah, I would be curious. Yeah.
Okay, cool. Maybe a small comment for you, maybe to better understand it. The idea is basically that you have a leaf and you put it under dark, so no photosynthesis occurs. And there's, of course, a photon channel in there. And afterwards, you put a very high amount of light on it. So then you know how much photons can travel through that photon channel, so there you know how much photosynthesis can the plant do. That is kind of the idea behind it, that you better understand what
it
was about.
Okay.
Okay, so if there is no further questions, thanks again, Julien, for great talk. And I hope to see you next week for another ETHNCEL seminar.
Goodbye. Okay, thank you very much for the invitation, David.